Hello and welcome. I'm James Murphy, and today we're writing a Sudoku solver for another LeetCode hard interview problem. In case you're not familiar, Sudoku is a puzzle game played on a 9x9 grid. You have to fill in the blanks so that every row, every column, and every block group of 3x3 cells has all of the numbers 1 through 9 exactly once. We're given that the board that we take into this function is going to be a valid board with a unique solution. Furthermore, we are meant to modify the board. We're supposed to solve the board rather than return a copy, which is solved. First things first, let's write a main function which does at least one test case. So here I take in the board represented as a big character array, and here is the expected answer that we're supposed to get. Then I create a solution class, which is really only needed for LeetCode problems. In a real code base, this would just be freestanding functions. But in any case, I create the solution class, I print out the initial board, I print out what I'm expecting, I do the solve, and then print out whether or not it did it correctly. So that's at least one test case. I've written this function. It's very straightforward just to convert this flat board into a vector of vectors, and this little function just to print out the board. After compiling and running it, we can see that we can print out the initial board, the expected board, and then our solution hasn't done anything, so of course it doesn't match. I think Sudoku is a classic example of a recursive backtracking problem, where the most obvious thing to do is look at the possibilities for what moves can be made, try one randomly, or try the first one, or try all of them, and then recursively solve the problem that way. So the real challenge for this problem is to decide, how do I store the information? Well, every row, column, and the 3x3 sub-blocks need to have all the numbers 1 to 9. So for each row, column, and cell, I'm going to keep track of which numbers have already been used. I've decided to do this using arrays of bit sets. A bit set is similar to a standard set, except it lets me store all 9 elements in basically a single integer. The way that it does this is effectively by using an integer and using the first, say, 9 bits of that integer to represent whether I have a true or false value in that location. So if the bit at the 0th index, the first bit, is set, then I'm using that to represent that 1 has already been used. This is especially useful because I can compute set operations on bit sets by using very primitive math operations like, for instance, I can compute the union of two bit sets just with the OR operator. I'm effectively just ORing the underlying integers, which are made up of those bits. The next step is to loop over the given board and mark out all of the integers that were already given to us. I loop over the rows and columns, and then if I see something which is not a blank, then here's what I do. I convert the digit to an index for the bit set, and then for the given row, column, and cell, I set the given index as being true, present. I did also write this little function, getCell, to compute which cell I'm in given the row and column. Then I just give all the information I've collected so far to this solve function, which we're going to write, which is going to do all the heavy lifting and the recursion and such. The purpose of the row and column starts here is to tell the algorithm where to start. Basically, it should assume that anything before this row and column start has already been solved, and to just progress forward. And of course, by before or after, I'm referring to an order where you go left to right and then top to bottom. The first thing that I want to do is find a position that's a blank, something that I can fill in. Finding the next empty position is pretty straightforward. I just loop through and check to see if it's a blank, and otherwise I keep getting the next row and column. Where here we see the implementation of what the next row and column is. It's just a little bit of math modulus trickery. It's pretty straightforward. The return value of next empty position is either a location that has a blank for me to fill in, or it's off the board. So I can use this as my base case. If everything has been solved up to row 9, then there's nothing more to do, and that's a solution. Note here that 9 is one index past the last actual row. The next thing I do is compute which numbers have already been used in the current row, column, or cell. That's what this line does. So remember, each of these things is a bit set, so I am ORing these sets together. The result is all the numbers that have already been used. At this point in the code, there must be a dot at the current location, So if everything has been used, then there's nothing I can use to fill in that dot, and so we return false. Otherwise, we loop over all the possible digits, and if that digit has not been used already, then we start the recursive backtracking. So here's what I do. I take the digit and put it on the board. Then I mark it as being used in the corresponding row, column, and cell. Then I recursively solve the problem. I'm using the return value of solve to indicate whether or not solve succeeded. If the solve is true, that means I was able to complete the board and find the unique solution after making the guess that I made. Otherwise, solve returned false, and so I need to undo that guess. So I unmark that guess from the row, column, and cell, and then move on to the next guess. If none of the guesses succeed, then importantly, I need to reset the current location to a blank and then say, this failed, I wasn't able to complete the board given the current stuff that's in the board. This allows me to backtrack up and potentially give another guess at an earlier stage. And that's pretty much it. Back up here in the main solve Sudoku function, I also want to point out that in a real code base, I would definitely want to check the return value, whether the final solve worked. But in this case, we're given that any input is going to have a unique solution, so we don't need to check it. Okay, so I compiled it and ran it, and you can see that with the initial looking like this and the expected looking like this, we do indeed find that we have a success and our algorithm was able to successfully solve the Sudoku. All right, I went ahead and submitted it, and we saw that the runtime was 4 milliseconds faster than about 98% and less memory usage than about 96%. So pretty good. That's all I have for this episode. If you liked it, be sure to tell your friends, subscribe, and don't forget to slap that like button an odd number of times. See you next time.